Well, good morning and happy Sabbath to all. This is the day that the Lord has made. We're going to rejoice and be glad in it. We are just so grateful today to have you worshiping with us. My name is Gresford Thomas, and I have the privilege of being the pastor here at the Concord International Seventh-day Adventist Church. And whether you're joining us online or whether you're joining us in person, we are just so grateful to have you with us today, and we look forward to worshiping the Lord with you. It's our prayer that you will receive a blessing by what you experience today. Just a few housekeeping things that we need to take care of, and that is a second reading for a transfer. We have to vote on it today. We have Ayala Haraburo from Sistac to Milpitas. And we have Jeanette Yalu from Sistac to Milpitas. And we have William Jackson. He'll be transferring from Sistac to San Ramon Valley Seventh-day Adventist Church. I just need someone to give me a motion that we allow these individuals to transfer to the locations of their choice. Is there a motion just by raising up the hand? Okay, there's a motion. Is there a second to that motion? Okay, second to that motion. Any more discussion? Okay, those in favor that are present, just raise your hand if I could see it. Okay, any opposed? Okay, that's carried. We will take care of that situation at our next board meeting when I meet with the clerk. Thank you very much for that. We can move on to a couple of other announcements of some importance. And the first is our food pantry, which we will be having today. It's going to be the last time we have it on a Sabbath day. We're going to be moving it to during the week. It's a little less cluttered when we have it during the week versus when we have it on Sabbath. But today it's going to be from 3 to 4:30, and we're going to be having it in our fellowship hall. We're going to be asking our volunteers to mask up and our people that are coming in to mask up, but that will allow the opportunity for them to choose the groceries that they need. But not only that, but it will also allow us the opportunity to interact with them. And I've already received some very, very interesting and kingdom-centric conversations with some of the people who have come through our food pantry. We've been doing it for that way for the past week or two. But that is from 3 to 4:30. If you'd like to help, we can use the assistance. It's not going to be as time or labor intensive as it was when we were doing the drive-through. In this particular venue, what we are looking for is just individuals to stand behind a table and greet people and let them know how many items they can take from a certain area. So it's more of a interpersonal or relational type of connection than it is running bags to a car and putting them in a trunk. So if you're interested in meeting up with people, getting to know our community, please come out at 2 o'clock to help out, between 2 and 3 to help out, to set up. Most of it is set up, so there won't be that much work. And then 3 o'clock when our guests arrive and we are able to meet them. I'm looking forward to it. We moved it to 3 partially because now I have the opportunity to attend. So I'm looking forward to being there after I worship at San Ramon Valley. Another announcement I'd like to make for something that's happening today. I see a few of you here, were here last night. The Pleasant Hill Adventist Academy was here, and if you weren't here, you missed a blessing. They came, and there was a choir, and then there was a full band. This entire stage was full of instruments, and there were like maybe 30 kids up here playing their instruments and giving glory to God. It was a sacred concert. There was a choir, there was a band, and then there was a string section as well. And they played for about an hour, and it was a beautiful, beautiful time of just hearing wonderful music, praising our God. Now, if you missed it and you would like to still hear music, there is another opportunity at the Pleasant Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church tonight. It's in your bulletin. At 7 p.m., there will be 12 of the 30 that were here last night that will be performing on the piano, the flute, the violin, clarinet, voice, guitar, and the harp. So if you would like to hear inspirational music, and you could drive up Pleasant Hills, just 5 miles south of here, correct? Yeah, south of where we are right now, southwest, I believe. So come and join us, and come and join them. I won't be there, unfortunately, but join them, and you'll be able to experience that beautiful music at that time. Just a few other announcements very quickly. Board members, we are meeting on Monday, 7 o'clock via Zoom. I will be in touch with the information, and we'll move forward with that. On Wednesday, we are continuing reading the book called Enjoying Your Bible. We've been having a beautiful time going through, learning how to engage and study the Word of God in a different way. We've been reading the book, but then we've been reading the Bible and studying the Bible using the techniques that we've been given through the book. And it's just been allowed for wonderful conversation and wonderful insights into the Word of God. So if you're still interested, it's still not too late. We're on chapter 11, but we're doing it section by section. So you won't miss a beat if you join us. The information is in your bulletin. For those of you joining us online that would like to participate in this, there will be information at the end of our broadcast today. Finally, two more announcements. Thursday is our prayer meeting. We continue to pray for our church, for our growth, for the Lord to just be present with us, for personal needs. Every Thursday from 7 to 8 via Zoom. We're doing it via Zoom. Join us if you would like. The information, once again, is in the bulletin, and it will be available online as well. And finally, there have been individuals that have been reading The Great Controversy together every Friday at 6:30 p.m., been going through and reading chapter by chapter of this fantastic book. And from what I've heard, I've not had a chance to join yet. It's been a blessing to those who have been participating. Again, the Zoom information is in your bulletin. And for those of you online, we will be there at the end of the broadcast where you can go in and go ahead and read and study this book together. There are a couple or more announcements here, but I'll let you read it in your bulletin. Those of you joining us online, you will see them at the end. But I just wanted to underline those few things because even though our church, we're still in this COVID, I mean, we're thinking we're out of it, but we're not quite out of it yet. So we're still in this COVID protocol situation, but our church is moving forward, and many more things will be happening in the future, and I look forward to sharing that with you. Let us have a word of prayer before we go any further and begin with our worship service. Please pray with me. Father in heaven, what a joy it is to worship you. What a joy it is to be here gathered together on this Sabbath day. Lord, I just want to pray a blessing on everything that happens in this place. May every mind and every heart be drawn closer to Jesus. May we learn to love him more by what we experience, whether it's the music or the spoken word or the prayers, whatever it is, Lord, may it touch each heart in a unique way, the way that you desire for each of us to be touched. So, Lord, guide us and bless us. Be with those who are joining us online. We're just so grateful for their participation as well. And for those who are here, I pray a special blessing on them. Oh, Lord, be with us as we continue in Jesus' name. Amen.
May we please stand for worship?
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation, and I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Amen.
Amen.
You guys may take a seat.
Good morning, church family. Happy Sabbath. It's just time for a congregational prayer. So if you would kneel or stand, whichever is comfortable for you. Our kind and loving Heavenly Father, we're grateful to you, Lord, for this beautiful Sabbath day. As we come into your house of worship, we ask, O God, for the guidance of the Holy Spirit. We invite the Holy Spirit to be with each person, touch each one present here and all who are in the hearing of my voice. We pray, O God, for your love, mercy, and grace to fill our hearts from above. We thank you, Lord, for life and health, the food and shelter, family, friends. We thank you for all things, great and small, most of all for Jesus, your dear and precious Son, who came to this dark world of sin and shame. He lived a perfect life, set examples for us to follow. Help us, Lord, that we will follow in your footsteps and we do the work that you set for us to do. We thank you for life, for all things. We thank you for your ever protective care over us. We thank you, Lord, that we're able to meet in freedom to worship you. And so, Lord, I ask, O Father God, for the anointing of the Holy Spirit upon every person present here and all who are hearing me, and to anoint the country, the people, and especially, Lord, the city of Concord. We pray for the anointing, special of the homes around our community. May each one be blessed, and may each one, Lord, seek to know you and come to know you and love you and accept you as Lord and Savior. We pray for those who are sick among us. We pray for your healing hand to reach out and touch them. And we pray for our family members and all who have families who are sick. We pray, Lord, for the victims of the country of Ukraine. We pray, Lord God, that you would be with those people. They've been thrown out of their homes and their country been rugged. And we pray, oh Father God, you would speak to the heart of this man who's caused all these problems and all these troubles. Bless your people. Bless those who are there helping them and feeding them and those who are doing the work. We pray for leaders. We pray for those who are spreading the gospel, taking the gospel around the world. We pray for our local churches, and we pray for all our pastors, their wives and families. And we pray for our elders, deacons, deaconesses, and all church officers and AV teams. Keep us, O Lord, focused on Christ Jesus our Lord. And may, Lord, whatever we say and do, we pray that it would be unto to your honor and glory. We pray you would bless our food pantry as it's grown, and we thank you for your leadership and your guidance. And bless the people who will come today. We pray, Father, that they'd be interested to know about you and to find out from us who we are and why we worship on Saturday, and they would want to know the God that we worship. Bless the pastor today as he preached. Give us all open hearts and receptive minds that we'll take the word that he gives us, the word of the Lord, and help us to live them out in our lives and to do what is right in your sight. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayer. Thank you for your blessings on each one of us. I pray for those who are homeless and those who are struggling and in need. I pray, oh God, their needs be met according to your will. Thank you for hearing us. And whatever I fail to ask of you at this time, oh Lord, I pray, oh God, may it be done according to your will. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Okay. Would you please stand for the scripture reading, please? And today's scripture reading is taken from Job chapter 42, verses 1 through 5. And I'm reading from the New King James Version. Then Job answered the Lord and said, I know that you can do everything, and that no purpose of yours can be withheld from you. You ask, who is this who hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore, I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. Listen, please, and let me speak. You said, I will question you, and you shall answer me. I have heard of you by the hearing of the ear, but now my eyes sees you. Amen. May the Lord bless the reading of his word and bless the hearers.
Well, once again, good morning to each and every one of you. Just so grateful to have the opportunity to speak before you. Before I go into the message, I just want to just underline, I spoke about it during the announcements, but I just want to talk about our food pantry, because we're kind of moving into a different phase now. And as I look back at the way that things have gone, it started out with just two or three of us. It was Ann and and Jerry, myself, and Hilda sitting around a table and talking and praying about what God can do through this ministry. We just had non-perishable goods, and now we've grown quite a bit. If those of you who want to see, just take a peek into the fellowship hall to see the setup and see the way that God has provided food from now four or five different sources that bring their food to our location, or where we get it and bring it to our location, and we're able to distribute it to our community. And not only that, but recently I've been getting calls from area churches, other sister Adventist churches, and we see what you're doing there at Concord International. We'd like to do something like that in our community, and they're asking how it can be done. Of course, the answer is it's the grace of our Lord. You know, there's a lot of things that can be done, but God has opened up so many doors, and I just want to share with you the blessing that has been happening through this food ministry, the connections we've been making through this food ministry. And as I've been thinking about it and praying about it, I realize that we've only just begun. We've only just begun to see what God is going to do. And as I look out, I see many individuals who in some way or another have touched this ministry or been involved in it. And thank you to each and every one of you. Those of you who've been praying for it, thank you to each and every one of you. This is a ministry that God planted here, and I believe he'll continue to bless, and many more will come from that. So I just wanted to talk about that just for a moment before we get into our message today. Let's have a word of prayer before we go any further. Father, I just pray that you would open my lips so my mouth may declare your glory, as the psalmist says. May the words that I speak be seasoned with your love and grace, and may everything that comes forth from this pulpit be for the honor and glory of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen and amen. Today, we're going to conclude a mini-series. It was a short series focusing on the life and times of Job. Of course, we could talk about Job quite a bit, and we could get into different details, and there were many chapters that I was going through, and I just kind of focused on one or two of these chapters. And the title of the series is Job, the Nature of Righteousness. Job, the Nature of Righteousness. And what we see is we're looking at the book of Job from a different lens. Instead of focusing on Job from the context of suffering and all the suffering that he went through, we want to look at it from the context of what the end result is, and that is through this experience, Job understood the righteousness of God, and he himself became a more righteous individual. Now, today we're going to define what this righteousness and how this process works a little bit more. And this message in my mind, in my estimation as I've studied it and prayed over it, is important because by God's grace, as we move forward and conclude this short study of the book of Job, we will see that Job cannot be just about suffering. The reason is the way that God runs his world cannot be reduced only to rewarding human righteousness and punishing human wickedness. See, that's what was going on with Job. He was calling out to God as if everything revolved around his suffering. But what we see is that God's purposes are not determined by a narrow view of this human retribution justice. His purposes reflect a wider concern for all of creation. And we're going to see that in the book of Job. I'm not just saying that. This is an observation from Job in the final chapters. In other words, what I'm saying is that when the Lord speaks, which is the title of our message today, when the Lord speaks, when he speaks, his intentions are looking at the entirety of the story, the whole thing. When we speak, when we pray, we're just looking at a summary. We're just looking at our current situation. But when God intersects with us, he's looking at the entirety. He's working all things together for our good. And sometimes as he's working it out, there may be tough things that we have to go through to get to the good things. Now, today what we're going to do is we're going to look at the final chapters of Job. And what we're going to see is that these chapters show us that God is a patient God who is not unwilling to hear our complaints, not unwilling to know our suffering. What I'm saying is it's okay to cry out to God. God is a big boy. He could take it. It's okay to tell the Lord all of your troubles and your sorrows. We also see that God is a merciful God who delights in expanding our minds and perspective about Him. There's a reason why the scriptures tell us, count it joy when you go through suffering of every time. Because what's happening is our worldview is becoming a universal view. Our worldview is becoming a heavenly view. Because as we go through these experiences, what's happening is God is shaping us into His image and helping us to understand how He works for our benefit. In the final chapters of Job, the Lord speaks and reveals the nature of righteousness. He reveals the nature of righteousness from the perspective of eternity. Now, if you'll remember with me, the book of Job, from a purely narrative or a story perspective, if we look at it from a once upon a time perspective, it's about a man who was put into a situation where he suffered economic, emotional, psychological, and physical ruin. The list can probably go on. Those are just four off the top of my head. And in the midst of it all, as he's going through all of these different circumstances, we see that he didn't blame God, but he did approach God looking for answers. He also approached God defending his innocence. What have I done to deserve this? You know, during that time, it was common to think that everything that happened is directly attributed to God. We see it in Scripture where they say, oh, the good comes from God and the bad comes from God. So whether you became rich or remained poor for your entire life, God was the one who played a role in your situation. Whether you were the picture of health or you're chronically ill, it was God who played the primary role in making that happen. Now, if you remember from the story of Job, the narrative, he became ill. His friends came over to see him, and their intent was to have him repent of whatever wrongdoing he had done against God. They were looking out for their friend. They saw what he looked like, and they remembered what he was, and they said, oh, Lord, what did he do against you? Whatever sin you're harboring in your heart, Job, just confess it so God will be merciful and perhaps he'll heal you. Job's response was to challenge the Lord and challenge his friends and give an account for his sufferings and the injustice that he saw in every corner of creation. I'm going to start by looking at Job 13, verses 24 and 26. In Job 13, what we're looking at is Job and his response to some of the interaction that he was getting from his friends what he thought he was receiving from God. It says in Job 13, 24 and 26, reading from the New King James, "Why do you hide your face and regard me as your enemy?" Wow, strong words. What have I done to become your enemy, Lord? And then he says, "For you write bitter things against me and make me inherit the iniquities of my youth." Job wanted answers. He needed to know why God was acting in what he saw as an erratic fashion. Everything was going well, and then this happens. Perhaps your life situation may not be as severe as Job's, but perhaps you're going through some erratic times right now. Perhaps you're wondering why God is not moving in ways that he should be moving. He's moving in ways that are contrary to the God that you read about in the Bible. Perhaps you're stuck in a situation where there seems to be no hope, no way out. Well, friends, we serve a God who says, I will never leave you or forsake you. And we see that in Job's experience, and that is the same for your experience as well. He is with us, and he speaks to us in the midst of our pain. He speaks to us when we lack hope. He speaks when it seems like there is no answer. When we cannot speak, when we don't know what to say, he speaks on our behalf. For us today, we are told in Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, I love this text. This is how God speaks to us. It says, God, who at various times and in various ways spoke in times past to the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, through whom also he made the worlds. Through Jesus, we hear the will, the desire, and hope of God. Through Jesus, we understand what it is God desires for us individually. Through Jesus, we find our way through this maze called life. God says things to Job, and we're going to look today at how he spoke to Job after Job had gone through all of these situations. We see how he's spoken to us through Jesus, but even though we have Jesus, there's still times when we need a word, an extra boost from the Lord, and the book of Job helps us to understand how to shape God's perspective in the midst of our narrow perspective. We're going to be looking at Job chapter 38. And if there's nothing else you learn from Job, these final chapters of the book, verses 38 through 42, sum up an important lesson. God gets the final word. In your circumstance, in your situation, God gets the last word. Job has spoken in this book, and then Job's friends have spoken, and then God has responded, but at the end of it all, at the end of the narrative, at the end of the story, all things work together for good when God gets the final word. You know, too many times we want to get the final word. We want to shape the narrative of how things are going. Nothing good could come from this. Or how long, O Lord? We want to resolve the problem or make the final decision in the many things that we face in our lives. But the book of Job teaches us, God teaches us through Job, that what we see is that when the Lord speaks, we need to stop, we need to listen, we need to meditate, and then we need to respond. Stop, listen, meditate on what we're listening to, and then respond. It's only when we follow this process that we can truly find peace. Otherwise, we're going to be running in circles. But when we do these things and just wait on the Lord and meditate and respond to what we find him showing us, to where we find him leading us, we find that we can have true peace no matter what the circumstance. Let's start by taking a look at Job chapter 38 as we look at this process a little bit. Job 38 verses 1 through 3. This is the end of the matter. These are the final words in the book of Job. Here God now comes out and he's going to be speaking. Job chapter 38, verses 1 through 3. Here's what it says. I invite you to look at the slide in the New King James. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, who is this who darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Now prepare yourself like a man. I will question you, and you shall answer me. The first item to note is that this is the first time since the beginning of the book of Job that we see this word, this capitalized L-O-R-D, this capitalized Lord. It's the name of God, Yahweh, the covenant God, the one who made promises to Abraham, the one who makes promises to us, God had been given his personal covenant name to Job. He says, it is me now talking to you. We see it at the beginning of the book when he's in the courts of heaven speaking to all of the rulers from the other worlds. But what we see is from chapters 3 to 37, this name, this L-O-R-D capitalized, is not used. God is called El Shaddai, God Almighty. It's a title. It represents who he is, but it doesn't identify him personally. In the book of Job, this has become a way of speaking of God as being detached and distant. Perhaps God will spare me. Job is losing his connection as he's going through all of these things, but God comes to him personally in the midst of his trials and says, I am going to show you the way out. I'm going to show you the why. In chapter 38, the author wants us to be in no doubt that it is God, L-O-R-D, the one that was at the beginning of the book, is now closing the book. Now the gracious Lord of covenant promise, he's here. He's here and he's on the case and he's going to reach out to Job. And I know I use this word covenant. And covenant is simply a relationship God establishes with people based on what he has promised. Not what we have promised. Not what we have done. But a covenant is a relationship based on what he has done and what he has promised. We don't have to do anything except believe the promise, except for accepting the promise. We don't have to make a promise back. We just have to believe the promise, and he's going to do everything through us. These promises are fulfilled when they are obeyed and believed. God is relentless in his desire to keep his promises. You see, friends, what happens is God makes these promises and then we ignore them, or we do the opposite of what the promises are. And in doing so, we say, oh, we're disobeying God. And yes, we are. But when we're disobeying God, what we're doing is we're pulling ourselves out of his presence and we're missing out on the benefit of that promise. God is relentless in his desire to keep us in his promises. It's like that hymn, standing on the promises. If we don't stand on those promises, we're going to sink and fall. What this means is he does all in his power to show that obedience to him, to show that claiming and accepting these promises is always the best course of action. So in Job chapter 38, the God whose name is Yahweh is associated with his personal presence of care, his personal love and faithfulness to the people of his covenant. He says, I'm coming to you personally, Job, as the one who's going to keep the promises that you knew of before all of this happened. The ultimate fulfillment of covenant is the coming of Jesus as a defenseless baby. When Jesus came to this earth, we received the promise of salvation. We receive the promise of victory over sin through him. We receive the promise of life more abundant through him. All of these are promises that we receive as we walk in covenant with God or walk in relationship with Jesus. If we accept and believe the promises found in verses such as this verse, which is very familiar, John 3:16, right? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, here's the promise, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. The promise is believe in him, the result is everlasting life. We don't have to do anything to get it, we just believe in him. This verse is simply an explanation of the covenant God wants to have with all of humanity through the person of Jesus. Eternal existence with Him. Eternal communion with Him. Not just through prayer, but face-to-face communion. That's what He wants. As we go back to Job chapter 38, verses 1 through 3, one other thing we see, we're just getting started with this verse, is that He comes in a whirlwind. This whirlwind, it represents, or a storm, it represents the presence of God. We see a whirlwind or a storm on Mount Sinai. When they were receiving the Ten Commandments on Mount Sinai, many of us, I'm sure, have seen the Ten Commandments, and you see the storm brewing. When that happens, when we see that storm, it means God's making His presence known to the children of Israel. We also see that a whirlwind or storm represents in the Bible the day of the Lord, the day of His appearing. One important item to note is God chose the day of His appearing. He didn't tell Job when He was going to come. He knew when the right time was to come. He knew when the exact moment was when Job needed to hear these words from God. It wasn't determined by anything Job did or said. It was based on the divine authority of the Lord, or Yahweh. He set the time and manner of His appearing to Job. And friends, as believers, waiting for the second coming of Jesus, we can learn something from this. We have many signs of what must happen before Jesus comes, but we can and will never know the exact time He will come. Jesus will come at the appropriate time for us to receive Him, just as He did for His first coming. Yes, things must happen. Things must take place. But sometimes we kind of jump the gun. Say, okay, this has happened. Jesus has got to come tomorrow. Our jobs as Seventh-day Adventist Christians who focus on the advent or the second coming of Jesus is to note the signs, but to hold back in predicting a time. Many have predicted, as far as I can tell, they're batting 1,000, they've all been wrong. We're not to focus on that. Our job is to ready ourselves and ready the world for that great and glorious day of the Lord's appearing. What our job is to do is to wait in a state of readiness and anticipation. We have an excitement knowing that it's coming soon. But we stand back from trying to do the math and think of the exact day and time and hour it's going to happen. So what we see from Job 38 is that Yahweh comes to Job in a divine and powerful fashion. The Lord responds not by evaluating the merits of Job's case, but rather by questioning Job's knowledge of the mysteries and purposes of God. That's what Job 38 through 42 is all about, through 41 actually, is all about. There's two speeches that God makes in there, don't have time to go through it, but I would invite you to read those chapters, because what we see that these speeches characterize a bunch of rhetorical questions. And these questions, what they're designed to do is to fully disclose that Job is not equipped to understand God's governance of the world. It's above his pay grade, as we say. Now remember, Job is, he's concerned about his personal suffering. In the midst of this, what he's thinking about is, Lord, why am I going through this? And what God is reminding him of is he's going through these different things that he has done in the way that he's created the world, is that he's reminding him that his perspective, God's perspective, goes beyond human suffering. It's about his kingdom and how his kingdom is governed. In the first speech in Job 38, God, he specifically challenges Job to understand the stars. You ever get in a clear location and see how many stars are actually up there? How many stars are actually that we could see with the naked eye? He tells him about his divine care over creation, and then he moves on and shows himself as a divine architect who alone knows where and how the foundation of the earth was laid and the true scope of creation. Just want to take a look at some of the verses here. In chapters 38, verses 4 and 5, it says, "Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me, if you have understanding, who determined its measurements? Surely you know." He didn't know, and neither do we. He establishes the creation as his own temple, the dedication of which was celebrated by the singing of the morning stars. To what were its foundations fastened, or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning stars, or the angels, sang together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy. Next, as he's going through, he speaks of his control over the chaotic sea, and let's stop and ask a question. How does talk of the stars or even of God's care for the seas, how does that serve as a proper response for Job? It's like, okay, yeah, you're God. You control all of these things. That's great. You're God and I'm not. The question people are seeking the answer to, how does it answer it? The reality is, while we may dislike our inability to penetrate the mystery of God, at some point, we are better off if we simply accept the reality of our own human limitations. What we see also is another very important lesson that Yahweh God is trying to give to Job is that a relationship of trust with God is more important than answers to our questions of why. Why this? Why so many questions? He says, come learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and you will find rest for your souls. His desire is to be in relationship with us, not to burden us with all of these existential questions. Even if he knew the answers to the questions, Job would not be satisfied with an intellectual solution. Job's deeper need, and this is what he didn't realize, friends. He thought if he had the answers, everything would be okay. But what we need to understand is Job's deeper need was to know that God had not abandoned him and that God still cared for him. What most people who are going through suffering need to realize is it's not about why, it's about asking for the presence of God to be there with you. The need to know that no matter what you're going through, the Lord speaks. This type of visitation is, of course, exactly what we have in Christ Jesus and his cross. He came down, he lived among us. He came down, he befriended human beings. He came down, he was there just with one another. He was face to face with those 12 men for all of those years and with individuals whom he ate with and laughed with and cried with. More than that, the cross of Christ, when he died for us, it's a divine participation in every aspect of our humanity, including and especially our suffering. Jesus understands because of what he went through on Calvary. We may not see answers for suffering, but we see Jesus. Here's what it says in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 9, as I come to a close. It says in Hebrews 2, verse 9, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than angels for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone. Everyone. Once we come to the realization that our narrow perspective is not enough to understand the ways of God, our viewpoint changes. Once we look to Jesus and see who he is and what he's gone through, our viewpoint changes. Our scripture reading today, found in Job chapter 42, it talks about how Job's viewpoint and mindset changed after he understood what God was trying to show him. That it's not about your suffering, it's about our relationship. Job chapter 42, verses 1 through 6. Here's what it says. Then Job answered the Lord and said, I know that you can do everything, and I know that no purpose of yours can be withheld from you. You asked, who is this who hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. Listen, please, and let me speak. You said, I will question you, and you shall answer me. But I have heard of you by the hearing of your ears, but now my eye sees you. Therefore I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes. The first thing we see is that Job acknowledges God's wisdom and power, and then he admits the validity of God's accusation that he, Job, had obscured knowledge and spoken ignorantly. He concedes that there are things that he spoke of that they're too wonderful to know. The Hebrew word is pele, which means that something that is extraordinary, something that is beyond our imagination. It means information in the divine realm that is beyond human understanding. In his final words, look at what he says. He distinguishes, this is important, he distinguishes between secondhand experience, the hearing of my ear, I heard about it, and firsthand experience, but now my eye sees you. God's greatest desire for us is not that we just hear about him, but that we also see him and experience the fullness of his love and his presence in every aspect of our lives and our trials. We see here that it says, therefore I abhor myself and repent in dust and ashes. It means that he's looking at himself as nothing or of no value. Job previously used this to describe how he felt about a sick condition. But now he sees that, you know, I don't understand your ways, so I can only trust in you. The expression goes beyond humility to self-abasement. What he is saying is he is deeply ashamed of his former presumption about God. In challenging God's ways. I did not understand things from your perspective. I didn't see it. And I still don't really know. I can't see it all. But now I know that there is a viewpoint, there is a perspective beyond me. And in order for me to claim or feel that perspective, I need to cling to you. As we turn our attention fully to Jesus, we are invited to have that same experience. Closing with Hebrews 12, verses 1 and 2. Last text, last thought. And I'm going to let this one stand on its own. I'm not going to go ahead and explain all that's there, but I want you to hear these words. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. May we look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, and realize that the nature of righteousness is knowing the only one who is righteous, Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we are just so grateful today for the opportunity we have had to see Jesus from this perspective, from the perspective of Job. Lord, I pray that you would guide us and allow us, Lord, to open our minds, that as we are going through trials in each one of us, everyone here is going through something, that we would look to you and realize that you are in control, realize that you are right now working things together for each one of our benefit. May we put our confidence in you. And in doing so, may we come to a closer and more loving relationship with Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen and amen. May God bless you.
May we please stand for worship.
Jesus' sacrifice for you truly mean? Jesus left heaven, his comfort zone, and he embraced the plight of fallen humanity. He accomplished his mission against fearful odds and dire resistance. Finally, he offered it all, his own life. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. As God's representatives, a sacrificial spirit is part of our true identity. That was the spirit demonstrated by our church's pioneers. John Andrews, for example, was a widower with two children when he accepted a call to go to Europe as the first official Seventh-day Adventist missionary. He accepted the call without knowing what his specific salary would be. They agreed to send him money from time to time, but did not do so as regularly as needed. To publish tracts, pamphlets, and the French periodical, Le Signe des Temps, he often used his personal funds, sometimes going without food and other necessities. He contracted pneumonia in 1877. After his examination, the physician commented, "This man is almost starved to death." 1 year later, Andrew's daughter died of tuberculosis. The committed missionary nevertheless relentlessly continued his groundbreaking work until he died of tuberculosis at 54. We live in a time when money and other resources are hard to find. Waiting for surplus or leftover resources to support God's mission could be a pious, well-intended wish, but may never be accomplished. In this context, these words of Ellen White are most relevant. The absence of self-denial in his professed followers, God regards as a denial of the Christian name. Those who profess to be one with Christ and indulge their selfish desires for rich and expensive clothing, furniture, and food are Christians only in name. To be a Christian is to be Christ-like. As we return our tithe and regular and systematic offerings, which we call promise, let us show a spirit of self-denial, which is the spirit of Christ. May we put our desires last and God first.
As we just learned in this video, we as Christians also need to practice self-denial as Jesus did, and also as that missionary John Andrews did in the video. We will not be considered a follower of Christ until we put God first and ourselves last, like they did. Returning a regular tithe and offering can be a first step towards self-denial. You can do this today by following the Adventist giving information, which will be shown on the screen at the end of our program today. Will the deacons please come forward to collect the tithes and offerings? Let's pray. Dear God, you are a generous God, and we ask that we may acquire your character of self-denial. We want to share as you did throughout our task this week. Please provide opportunities for us in this means. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's close this worship service with a reading of Romans 15:13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You are dismissed. Have a wonderful Sabbath.